Good morning, dear colleagues. As Andrei told you before me, we can make several non-trivial predictions out of this hypothesis. I will stop on the four of them. The first one, oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes, and differentiation genes co-evolve. The number of oncogenes have to correspond to the number of cell types. Number three, evolutionary novel genes are expressed in tumors. We call them seen genes. And number four, evolutionary young curves are tumor specifically expressed. We started with the fact that with the analysis of various functional classes of human genes, the functional classes were defined based on the databases we've taken them from. We have analyzed the human protein oncogenes, genes of tumor suppressors. And we used genes coding the tumor suppressor genes as a control box. We also analyzed the genes from our lab with the help of TCGA, also all the housekeeping genes, and we repeated the cancer testis antigens analysis. We carried out this analysis with the help of Protein Historian software that we used for phylogenetic analysis of protein coding sequences, and Hammer was used to analyze non-coding sequences. Like genes with tumor-specific activity. In the result of this analysis, we had such curves. Here you have the ratio of genes in each of the taxons, and the taxons are defined as dots. Well, here we have million years, the horizontal axis. In order to describe these curves numerically, we were using the period of semi-evolution of the 50% of genes of this particular class. Now let's look at these curves. The phylogenetic distribution of housekeeping genes, age and the oncogenes age, tumor suppressor age, differentiation genes, Hammer box containing genes, apoptosis genes, cancer testis antigens on chromosomes, BMC globally subtracted protein coding genes, non-coding genes of the same kind, and CTX antigens, and finally BMS globally subtracted non-coding genes on X chromosome. It is immediately seen that semi-evolution curves form three separate classes. The first one includes tumor suppressors, differentiation genes, and oncogenes, and the other ones younger classes. The existence of these classes was confirmed with the help of statistical analysis. The figures here show the significance of untrustworthiness of each branch of this tree. And these classes, first class and third class, are really. And class number two really exist. The first cluster includes differentiation genes, tumor suppressors, and oncogenes. And it is between the housekeeping genes and all block coding genes of the human beings. It is interesting that the curves practically repeat each other, and it speaks about the onco evolution of these genes. Thus, it proves that tumors may play a role in the new cell type formation. The second class includes homeobox genes, apoptosis genes, CT antigens on autosomes, and BMC, globally subtracted coding genes. What is interesting, the first cluster and the second cluster the difference between them is several hundreds million years, which proves that first the cell type occurs and then the genes that form new tissue out of this cell type. And finally, the youngest cluster, number three, that includes non-coding sequences, BMS globally subtracted, XCT antigen genes, and since X chromosome is evolutionary new, we have separated the non-coding genes that are located on the X chromosome. Thus, we have demonstrated the existence of a whole series of classes of evolutionary novel genes, tumor-specific ones. The majority of these genes may be seen in the primates. You may see this much better here. Different primates and the greatest difference of the third cluster comes onto stage after the primates appeared. The genes we found in our lab, the non-coding genes on X chromosome, occur and evolve most actively for the last 67 million years period, and most actively for the last 5 years between chimpanzee and the human being. Quite naturally, if we speak about some new evolutionary paradigm, we have to check not only the human being, but other species as well. We carried out similar analysis for murine genes analysis. Both the first and the second clusters also exist. Oncogenes, differentiation genes, and tumor suppressor genes also evolve, and the second cluster lags behind several hundred million years. But the tumors may be seen not only in the vertebrates, but in the invertebrates as well. So we have looked at the invertebrates. We checked Drosophila melanogaster and Strabismus and confirmed that this phenomenon most probably is characteristic for the evolution of all the living mechanisms. And then we decided to compare all the cell types and the number of oncogenes in various taxons and various organisms. And as you see, there's really a correlation between the number of oncogenes and the number of cell types. Where you see an A, it means that the number of cell types, we couldn't find it. This data, we found them in publications, various publication sources. There is a correlation, certainly. These are morphological cell types, mind you. And now, endogenous retroviruses. Endogenous retroviruses were part of the human cell genome in various times. And the youngest are endogenous retroviruses of the K family. And thus we decided to analyze their expression as well as the expression of H family endogenous retroviruses that are a little bit older. That's the expression of K family in a normal lymphocyte, and that's H family in a normal lymphocyte. K family do not express practically at all, while H have a high level of expression. What happens in the tumor? If we take lymphoma, we'll see a drastic growth of K family. In other organs, K family expression in normal cells of the lung and small cell carcinoma or small cell lung cancer. Thus, we have demonstrated that phylogenetic distribution of the ages of oncogenes, tumor suppressor genes, and differentiation genes almost coincide and belong to the same cluster, which proves that these gene classes co-evolve. With another method, we have confirmed that the evolutionary novelty of cancer test is genes, and have shown the evolutionary novelty of genes of non-coding tumor-specific expressed RNAs. The number of oncogenes corresponds to the number of cell types, and evolutionarily young retroviruses in tumors are really expressed more actively than in norm, while the older HERVs have practically the same level of expression in tumors and in normal tissue. Thank you. Your questions, please.
Сюда микрофон принесите, вот сюда, на первый ряд.
So within the non-coding genes,
yes.
What is the proportion of the mRNA, given that so many are studying the microRNA non-coding region?
I think we analyzed, we didn't analyze the microRNAs, we analyzed long non-coding RNAs.
These are only long non-coding regions?
Only long non-coding RNAs, yeah.
There are some, at least, we describe at least one microRNA in these genes, but it was not systematic study.
So within that curve, we don't see the microRNA.
Mm-hmm. Among non-coding RNA, we published on one microRNA and on one long-coding RNA.
The two.
Mm-hmm. But we do not know the proportion.
Andrei, can you tell me, please, based on the tumor, we may check which oncogenes cause mutations of specific tumor-suppressing genes. What is the time when these oncogenes occurred in these tumor suppressing genes. Who came first onto stage? We actually started such studies, but it takes too much time and efforts. Oh, I had a student who started working on this topic, and there are specific combinations, as far as I remember. We checked the oncogene suppressor pair. Up to now, I can't tell you about a specific correlation. In some cases, the oncogene came first onto stage, but in some cases, the suppressor, tumor suppressor. But this is our future. I have an impression, based on what we are analyzing now, that the later tumor suppressor mutate more often than the older tumor suppressor. You mean that the younger tumor suppressors are more often inactivated in tumors compared to older ones. On the whole, no controversies. No, I probably won't be able to answer. There are more suppressors compared to oncogenes. And then it is quite possible what Alexander Vasilievich said right now, but this is a topic of a separate study. More questions? Tell me, please, the number on this evolutionary novel genes has increased drastically now. And we have to apply algorithms on the basis of their functions and maybe the mechanisms that led to their formation. Can you explain to me how you plan to resolve this task? What will your approaches be? In terms of functions, we may use defendology, GSA7 software that proves the involvement of these genes. As for the mechanisms that led to the formation of these genes, in fact, for this we may use the ordinary evening and check whether this is a de novo gene or something else. Екатерина Колова will tell you that the number of functions dramatically increases. There is a condition called protogene. When the gene is born, it still it has no functions, but then the number of functions dramatically increases. And we analyzed the genes based on protein ontology. Practically no global functions, only on the molecular levels. But the oncogene function already exists, and kinase and regulation and transcription of binding with DNA. Different molecular functions, which may give birth to whatever afterwards, especially when we speak about transcription regulation, or maybe we're talking about new transcription factors. It's difficult to believe. There must be a certain trend since we see more and more of such genes. So they must be needed for something. We have a kind of an outbreak. So they must have certain functions. As an alternative, there has to be a reason why these genes are now appearing in such great numbers compared to previous times. As far as I understand, new genes formation is a general evolutionary trend. But you say that the common to stage for the human beings quicker compared to chimpanzee. I didn't say quicker. I said that a great number of non-coding sequences came onto stage in between chimpanzee and the human beings. We can compare chimpanzees with other primates. I can't say that they evolve more quickly in a human being. We did not carry out this kind of analysis. And look, now the domineering concept in the world is that all morphological evolution is connected with the regulatory elements. While the morphology science formed based on combinations and existing genes. While the theory on the genes say that there are new genes coming onto stage and there are thousands of new human genes. And even outstanding geneticists can't explain this. They sometimes think that the human evolution is over and they can't answer the question why the new genes come onto stage. And the even housekeeping genes, these are very ancient genes. Many people think that they we all know them all, but still we have now new housekeeping genes. So this must be needed for some reason. What I want to say is that this process of new genes and new functions is not sufficiently studied. Look at the molecular evolution, mainly the duplication way of new genes formation. While new functions, certainly, gene ontology is already great. At least we can analyze things now, which functions are developed from the gene of a human being. So this is really exceptionally interesting, but this we have to reconsider this from another point of view. We have to create new paradigms. And we have to think about what is going on in biology. I would like to comment one thing that, to my opinion, is highly underestimated in connection with one of the questions, why these new genes, or what for? The majority of at least known processes in nature are based on the stochastics. Constantly, changes go on in living organisms. New variants of genes come onto stage because they have mutations that are not actually mutations, but the source of heterogeneity of the genes. And quite naturally, stochastically, with high incidence, new genes may be formed. How they could be characterized, these new genes, when they are formed in such an amount? First and foremost, by what your genes have. They have no functions. The functions will either be added or not, and this is also a stochastic process. If they occur, if they are formed, these genes will be selected in the course of evolution, will start taking part in some processes. If not, they will remain a good diagnostic material. And we have to use this as well. But this predisposition, like if the stars exist, every if the stars light up in the sky every night, then somebody needs them. This doesn't exist in nature. The line about the stars is from a famous Russian song everybody knows. But since we have so many genes, there must be a certain function, even though we don't see it. It has to be studied and analyzed. In tumors, all the processes go on much quicker compared to normal tissues, and this may be one of the reasons. But everything has to be analyzed and studied. But this stochastic side of life has to be always remembered. I would say that it has undergone the selection of a certain kind and has some profile of expression, so it's not by accident. There was a philosopher, Karl Popper, who introduced the phenomenon of the space of opportunities, and he applied it to the philosophy of life. The evolutionists, the morphologists, use a term of morphological opportunities, unrealized opportunities space. And we're talking about the tumors that are a search engine within the space of unrealized opportunities. This is our orthogenesis of a kind. And if we understand these trends, maybe with the help of artificial intelligence, we will understand how to differentiate the tumors. If, roughly speaking, we can extrapolate the formation of the function of this gene, try it in vitro, this will be exactly the drug that we have to administer to the patient in order to suppress the future functions of this tumor. This is highly scientific because the unrealized opportunity space is a scientific term. But on the other hand, this is subject to experimental analysis, especially using the supercomputers of nowadays, when we can simulate molecular evolution very well. We have analyzed backwards, but we can do the same moving forward. I think this is an extremely interesting discussion, a very useful one, and especially that the young people can listen to the opinion of Evgeny Davidovich,